Hey there, it's Anace. A year ago today, I posted my very first video on this channel, and I recently hit the arbitrary but also very substantial number of 20,000 YouTube subscribers, so I wanted to make a video about it, turning the tables on you. So instead of me telling you about something sciencey that I just found out, I wanted to tell you about 20 things that you have found out about and told me on my videos. A tribute to all of you who support me, who comment on my videos, who tweet me fun science on Twitter, and send me amazing feedback. So without further ado, I present you with some of the most excellent comments and suggestions, and a few overdue mistake corrections. I'll kick this off with my video on the four flaws in our eyes. One of you did spot a slight argument flaw referent to blind spots in that video. In that video, I talked about a pilot needing to continuously scan the horizon to avoid missing oncoming objects in the anatomical blind spot, which is the one formed by the optic nerve. One of you pointed out that generally speaking, a pilot will have the information from the other eye to fill that information in. However, this made me go back and research a little bit further, and I learnt that there are instances where something such as the windshield post of an aircraft could block out an object through one eye and for it to be concealed by the blind spot in the other. So you would still need to scan horizontally. And the other reason to scan is due to our poorer peripheral vision, which has a lower resolution, which I actually talked about in my 12-dot illusion video. And if you're flying at night, you've also got the problem of the night blind spot, whereby your central vision, which requires more light, is unable to see anything at night. So pilots do need to scan using their peripheral vision to make sure that they don't crash into any oncoming objects. I've left a link in the description if you want to find out a little bit more about the precise instructions that pilots need to use when flying, and I've also linked each video I'm referencing with each of these points, in case you haven't watched them and you would like to go and watch the original. Next up is my video on Pi Approximation Day, which coincides with my birthday, and it was all about the history of approximating pi. Luke Myers, who apparently shares the same birthday as me, told me about Fabrice Bellard, who created the fastest binary computing algorithm to approximate pi, and it's 43% faster than the one it was originally based on, and is actually the algorithm that's used to check other algorithms computing digits of pi to make sure that they're actually generating the correct digits. At the end of my video on why do rainbows have seven colours, I asked you to come up with a mnemonic like Richard of York gave battle in vain so you wouldn't have to memorise the colours of the rainbow again. That represented the number of colours that you thought the rainbow should have, and there were many excellent suggestions, but I think my favourite was rhyming yaks get better violins and regular yoga gives bodies vigour. So, nice one. In my video about Browns do better than Smiths, which is all about how having a surname earlier on in the alphabet is likely to give you some small advantages in life, I learned from you that Jeff Bezos, the founder and CEO of Amazon.com, chose the name Amazon for that reason, because back then websites were very likely to be listed alphabetically, so being at the top ensured your discovery. And also, fun fact, he was originally going to call his website Cadabra, which comes from Abracadabra or Abracadabra. But after his lawyer misheard that as cadaver, he changed his mind about it. The 12-dot illusion video was actually inspired by the user Yes, I'm a bit geeky on Twitter, who tweeted the illusion to me and wondered how it worked. And it is questions precisely like that one that inspire me to make new episodes, so thank you. And other amazing things witnessed on Twitter include cute animals and even requests for bug IDs, all of which are always welcome. Now this may seem like the epitome of first world problems. Epitome, not epitome. It probably isn't the first mispronunciation I've made in my videos, and I'm sure it won't be the last, but it's still frustrating when it happens. However, I do appreciate it when you respectfully point it out to me. Unlike Spanish, English is tricky when you learn some words through reading rather than through listening, and the pronunciations honestly just aren't as straightforward as they are in Spanish. Also in that very same video, I actually quoted the wrong tax escalation. The 17.5 figure I cited is wrong. VAT in the UK is now 20%. And I also learned that biscuit in the US is apparently not the same as biscuit in the UK. In my video on mimicry, I asked whether you were able to spot the real bee out of a sea of flies, and 50% of you found it correctly, whereas 50% guessed incorrectly. Hence, I learned that hoverflies can still trick humans, though hopefully by the end of the video, you will always be able to tell apart your dipterans from your hymenopterans. I was very pleased with my cyborg beetle video because it deals with hacking into insect fight, which is quite obviously my topic, until my friend Alex, who works on the same species of beetles, pointed out to me that my claim of Mycinorhino torquata ugandensis being the largest species was wrong. Although they are most likely one of the largest flower beetles that routinely fly, As it turns out, I verified this claim in the worst possible way. I googled it and I found some beetle sellers who deceptively and incorrectly labelled Mycinorhino beetles as Goliath beetles, and foolish me took it as fact because I'd already done my work deciphering how they fly. Anyway, lesson learnt, don't slack off on any of the research. Ever. In November, I made a two-way collaboration with the lovely Ali from Neurotransmissions, and we made a video about Tourette's over on her channel. Until I knew that my tics were due to Tourette's, I had always been very self-conscious about them, and whilst I'm a lot more accepting of them today, I do always notice myself ticking when I'm collaborating with others. However, even though some of you do notice my tics, none of you seem to mind, so I guess the somewhat cheesy thing I learnt was that I'm probably way more critical of myself and my work than others are, so thanks for enjoying what I make and for accepting me the way I am. Last year, I also went to Naukas, which compelled me to launch a new series, Raw Curiosity. It's a series that has thumbnails that look like this, and they are slightly less polished than my usual sciencey episodes, but they allow me to hopefully add a little bit of extra depth to this channel. Anyway, at Naukas there was a live interview with astronaut Pedro Duque, who thought competition was slightly better at propelling science than collaboration. So I quizzed you, and most of you disagreed with Pedro, and felt that collaboration, in most cases, was a stronger driving force than competition, although of course these aren't necessarily mutually exclusive. In my video about how lifetime monogamy leads to the evolution of superorganisms, aside from observing people take this claim in wildly separate directions, from those who thought I should burn in hell for speaking about evolution, to those who thought I had a pseudo-scientific religious agenda by trying to make people only be monogamous, I also had a more serious point brought to my attention. I'd say it was more an issue of my own editing. Basically, I gave the impression that queen bees can live for several decades, which isn't quite true, because I animated that particular point using queen bees that I'd already drawn beforehand, rather than with queen ants that I hadn't bothered to illustrate. Usually, it is obligate eusocial ant species who have extremely long-lived queens, on the order of 10 to 30 years. Now don't get me wrong, queen honeybees live for a very long time, but not quite as long as ants. And also, that video generated some very, very interesting questions and discussion, so I do intend to make a follow-up video on it at some point. My video on habits was a very interesting one to make because I ran a survey, and that meant that your answers greatly influenced the content of the video, a little bit like this one. And that being said, I didn't really promote the survey properly on YouTube, so I think only those who followed me on Twitter and Facebook actually filled it in. However, it was nice to see that those who watched the video did note that the underlying advice backed by science had applied for them in the past. For instance, Will from the channel Political Junkie said, "That point about holiday travel is spot on. I lost a lot of weight after I first moved to Madrid because the new environment broke my habit of taking my car through drive-ins and forced a new habit of walking to the local supermarket." In my video of Why Did Two Sexes Evolve, I fell into the fallacy of using theory and hypothesis interchangeably, which several of you thankfully reminded me of. In science, a theory is very different to a hypothesis. A hypothesis attempts to answer a question by means of an explanation that is yet to be properly tested, whereas a theory is an explanation that has already undergone extensive testing and is accepted as being an accurate explanation for a phenomenon, such as, for instance, the theory of evolution. Anyway, it should be pointed out, in that video I was just talking about hypotheses. Unfortunately, there were no theories. Also, this video received one of my favourite comments I've received ever. And then you hear this sound. The Trappist video was a lot of fun to make, and quite a few of you pointed out that there were a few aliens on their evening stroll and a few dogs bounding around in the background, so I think next time I travel to an exoplanet, I'm going to examine it a little bit more closely before claiming that we can't live there. You all seemed to really enjoy the bat video. It was basically journal club in video form. It was a critique of a study which claimed that bats were the fastest flying animals using some very dubious methods, and some of you came up with some excellent suggestions to improve the experimental design to track the bats. Ossiebird suggested the use of GPS trackers, and the science channel Think About It actually went ahead and found out the status quo of today's technology in that regard. The glass battery video. This one actually went slightly viral, which is definitely very exciting, but as with anything that extends beyond the normal lovely circle of people who watch my stuff, it also brings out some of the worst in people. However, there were some very valid critiques and discussions, and the major one was that glass is not a viscous liquid as I claimed, but an amorphous solid. It should be noted that glass itself is more of a viscous liquid. Point taken. Thank you to everyone who came along to the very first live stream ever on Draw Curiosity. I know it wasn't the best, and I really appreciate those of you who stuck through the technical difficulties and the poor quality. There were some great suggestions and feedback to conduct it better next time, including potentially recording it on my nice camera as I live stream and then repost the higher quality video instead. I conducted a poll in my recent memory video, that is, if you remember, because it's all about how you can't trust your memory. Anyway, if you haven't watched it yet, I would recommend watching that first before this because it will spoil a bit of the video for you. So I'll give you a couple of seconds to go, I'll just wait here. Okay, well in that video I asked whether people could pick out the person who was whispering at the start, and a whopping 40% of people did not even remember they had seen that clip, and 1 in 10 picked out the wrong person. So anyway, it proves the point I was making. And finally, I just want to show some of the wonderful puns as seen in my comment section. They always give me a chuckle, so hopefully they will make you smile too. Or groan, but preferably smile. Now, I know we've already done 20 things and my voice is running out, but I really wanted to add something extra at the end. I really, really appreciated that many of you showed support and a positive response towards me thinking of Patreon. I think Patreon will probably have to happen soon because my PhD funding is approaching its end, but I also wanted to mention that I recently attended VidCon Europe and I now have a producer, which is particularly exciting. It means I'm going to be able to fund a few episodes through sponsorships, and as a heads up, the next episode on this channel is going to be sponsored. Now I know many of you already watch YouTube channels who regularly integrate sponsorships into their content and you don't mind, but I'm also aware of others who have mixed feelings about sponsorships. So I wanted to reassure you that these sponsors are carefully chosen and they're not going to change my content other than adding a brief 30 seconds to my video. And most importantly, they're going to help me to increase the quality and the quantity of what I produce, they're going to help me break even, and they directly support me in my work as a science communicator, which to me means a lot. So anyway, thank you so much for making it to the end of this mammoth video, for all of your support, for your lovely comments, your input throughout the past year. And as always, thank you so much for watching me, and I'll see you in the next one.